My name is Arturo. I'm here today for a story that I want to tell you. Do you want to hear my story?
Yes.
Good. Good answer. So let's move forward quickly. And the story is called Warka Water. Warka Water started in 2012, and I was traveling through a beautiful country, Ethiopia. It was like traveling in another time, another age. You see, this image could have been taken anytime. People that live in such an harmonious way with nature, with the environment, they use local material to build houses. I was amazed, but at the same time, I was also shocked to see, for my very first time, children, women collecting water, as you can see, from unsafe sources, from, you see, they share with animals. And they carry this water from on very heavy duty water tank, and they walk without shoes for kilometer. And this is happening now, this is happening every day. Many people doing it, it's a procession. Back home with this, you know, strong experience in mind, I start thinking as a designer, as an architect, how can I help for, you know, for this situation? From the very first sketch to reality, 4 years, I will show you how we did it. So as an architect, I always look for inspiration. I look around me, I look at nature, I look at ancient tradition. And in this case, the Warka tree was very inspirational. The Warka tree is a tree that grows in Ethiopia. And the community that doesn't have the Warka tree is not very honorable. Under the tree, they do what we are doing now. They do presentation, gathering, they do educational training. And the tree is offered them everything because it's offering food, it's a fig tree, it's offering oxygen, and they know that shelter, because under the tree is very pleasant. And they keep people, they keep the tree alive, even deforestation is going on. So the tree is very intelligent because it's using people to maintain it. And this is the principle of Warka. And now these images, they don't need any words, they explain themselves, that it is possible to harvest water from the atmosphere. And nature is doing it every day. Insects, plants, the cactus is an expert. Even in the most arid place in our planet, they know how to do it. So after at this step of the research, I was wondering to myself, but if we know all this today, we have this technology in front of our eyes, why we don't apply it to our building, our cities? And the answer I get to myself was very astonishing, because actually, thousand and thousand years ago, we already did it. There are samples like this one, the DuPonts. They are showing that in North Europe, we managed to collect water by condensation. And this is the result. This structure still exists. We are discovering it now. And you see how well they integrate to nature? And animals, livestock, they are still using them. So, why we forgot? Or this other structure around the Mediterranean Sea, there are dry stone walls or buildings. The air passing inside the buildings release, because inside is cooler, some water, because air always contains some humidity. And drop by drop, a reservoir of water is created, and this water is alimenting and is, you know, providing to plants around, to trees around, a source of life. Or other example, there are many examples, beautiful, amazing, forgotten. So Warka Water has been designed, in fact, keeping some few objectives very clear. Easy to be constructed, low environmental impact, locally made, offering the community at least 50 liters of water, potable water every day, and to cost around $1,000. So this was the initial goal. And we're working very hard, and it's been a real challenge. And since we built 15 prototype, full-scale prototype, so you can imagine very big. And the number 3 you see underlined is the one I want to show you today in detail. So basically it's made out of few material. There is a mesh, there is a collector that is collecting the water falling from the mesh and condensating water. The water tank, there is a frame, which is in bamboo, holding everything together. And there is a canopy around that is providing the shade. So the shade is keeping the water cool and also the environment fresher. And what it is, basically, it is a tower made of modules. So the modules pre-constructed are built and piled from bottom up, without scaffolding, without machinery, without energy. And what it does when it rains, we are very happy we collect water from the rain. When it's not raining, but there is high humidity in the air and fog, we harvest fog. And when there is no rain, no fog, but there is different in temperature between night and day, condensation happens, and we harvest also this water. So natural phenomenon, low-tech, passive structure, doesn't use energy, and we try to get the best from the environment. But harvesting water is only one element of the process. Then, once we have water, we have to store it, which is a science itself. And after this, we have to filter and to distribute it to the community. So Waka Water is all this. So providing water is the main function, and this is clear. But within the time, we also providing other resources like food, for instance, social space, education for children, economy, working with the artisan, as well as we tested illumination, was very successful. So immediately in place where there's no electricity, you place a light and life happen. Children, they can read and study, while during the day they collect water, they have more time for themselves. And behind the project, there is a lot of research going on the water cycle, which we know very well today. From the very first prototype we built, this we are testing since 4 years, different environmental condition. This is a portrait, how to collect water. This is a standard mesh for agriculture. Then today we have been a little bit further. We develop even a three-dimensional mesh that is more efficient on this. But the principle is the same. And this is what happened, in fact. When water is created, drop by drop, falls down, and the noise is very beautiful. And I would like to invite everybody on this planet to hear that, because if we got the consciousness how much work is needed and nature is doing for us to create water, we will have more attentive how we, you know, consume it and how we use it. And we test night and day different material to see which one is the more appropriate, and so on and so on. So from the trip and the travel in Ethiopia, to make it reality, we also have to research funding, because without money, little we can do. And thanks to the crowdfunding, we reached the goal we wanted, so we prepared our luggage and we went to Ethiopia again. And we chose a location that is south Ethiopia, close to Kenya, in a beautiful location that is 2,400 meter highlands, above a huge Abaka Lake, which you can see from the picture. And this is the community we have been working with for more or less three months. And when it rains, they get this water. I call them one day river, because after one day, they are gone, they go to valley, and they collect as much as they can, and they store it. So you can imagine the quality of this water. At the same time, in these highlands, they have clouds crashing onto it. Even during the day, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, it's very hot, there is fog. And this is a potential water they don't get. So it's lost. And the community are very nice people. They are weavers. What they do, they create threads, they create textile, they make it, and they sell it in local market. They do these beautiful things, and they survive with that. At the same time, they also weave amazing structure. This is out of bamboo. They split the bamboo in parts, and they construct these huge houses. I don't know if you ever seen it. They can go up to 14 meters. And with it, the time, they get shorter and shorter, up to when they are too small. And this is another story, maybe for another time. But let's go back to work. So we start working with the community, and they use bamboo. They cut bamboo without tools. That for them is natural. They make it easy and precise. So now the students from the Addis Ababa University are showing how to construct one module of Waka out of split bamboo. So it's a simple process, And so we are teaching and we are showing and forming also the community how to do it. So out of the 2D, let's say, carpets, then we fold it and we make a 3D structure. So we have been working, and it hasn't been easy. Now telling the story seems like, you know, all is going very smoothly. In reality, it's not like this. But anyway, things have been progressing. And you see life around the village was going on while we were building the work. And everybody was wondering, you know, what will be the final result? And I was very anxious, you know, to that moment, the moment where we were been showing to the community, like, you know, everybody around the project, like now, the result. So working with the community has been very, very important for the project, because we learned many things, like this one. For example, the lady is scratching the banana tree trunk and is getting, you know, the pulp. They bake it, they make pizza. But what is left is not thrown away, but this fiber, they do cables. And cables are very important for the Warka project, because it's a tall structure and needs cable to stabilize. So we did cables with them on spot, and I learned about this technology, but there are many more has been brought through this experience. So this is the environment, women, children, everybody helping what they can do in order to, you know, to make it happen. And this is Africa, it's incredible. So finally, the day of the presentation was arrived. All the community was around the site, was more than 400 people, all dressing elegant, as you can see. So I was there for directing the construction, but also the only chance we have to demonstrate that it's possible, we can make it there, and to leave it for testing. So this is the work at the very beginning, 8 o'clock in the morning. 9 o'clock, the first module was set into the ground. By 11, we had all the modules ready for installation. And then I call everybody, like I'm asking you now, come and help us. 1 hour and we will be finished. So people, they start coming. And the tension was very high because, again, they were not trained. The first time we were mounting it. And the wind was super strong. I don't know if you can feel it from the image, but normally you don't do this activity with wind. And I was strong, but it was the only window we had to build it. So, but fortunately, less than half an hour, and we made it. And when we made it, was a change. I could see it in the face of the people, because finally they understood what we were doing, and they did it themselves. They were part of it. So that's been integrated immediately with the community. So we fixed the canopy, and after this, it was done. So I went back to the chief of the village, which is this old man, very respected, and I told him, do you like it? Can we keep it? Or you want us to remove it and go away? And without saying one word, even not looking at me, looking at the community, they start immediately singing and dancing all around. And I was so happy, because finally, after so much, you know, work and dedication, to see your clients as an architect dancing under your building is a unique experience. I think only in Africa can happen. So, finish this phase. Now, what is the next? The next is, in fact, the problem of potable water scarcity is global. We are working now mainly in Haiti, where in the south was this problem with the hurricane. So we went there, we visited the situation, and it is dramatic, as you can see. Nature is taking over. You see trees are growing, but the destruction is there. We choose the site, which is this one you see. And this is the community we are working at the moment. And this is the situation, you see. 360 degrees, just to give you an idea, even trees are gone. Some they start, and all the structure, the shelter, everything is destroyed. So infrastructures as well, and they have no access even before to potable water. So we start working with bamboo. The same things is as we see in Ethiopia is now, you know, taking over. Except these new things, we are adding a new item to the project, the solar power. Through very lightweight solar panel, organic one, we provide an energy for a charging mobile phone, computer, tablet, satellite connection, so we could give children from the community the access to internet, to information, as well as illumination in the night. And for this, we are running now a new campaign, a new crowdfunding, and if this is successful, we will go ahead. So in order to do this, we are working now on a new project called Cultura Porte, which we are working actually with Warka, with the same artisan, on art craft they can, you know, produce. They have amazing skills that they can do incredible things using, you know, natural material and technique we have lost. So looking at these things, looking this way to work, keeping this, you know, tradition alive, but bringing new products with, you know, a modern touch, let's say, that can be also appealing for us. The intention is to keep these people working, so happy, to keep this tradition going and transmit it from father to children. We work with metal, we work with natural fibers, we work with many different materials. All local and all, you know, part of the local culture. And we transmit this culture through this conference, through other exhibition. We produce this, we sell it internationally, we show them, and we talk about Tahiti, we talk about Ethiopia, we talk about this local reality in a new way, in a modern way, then making it a little bit more, you know, interesting for also for the young generation. And they are very happy and very proud to be exposed to you, to the European public, to the national public. And we do it with a message, because culture is something you can wear and you can bring to you and you can talk about and we can share. It is important to bring this message. And also we integrate it with the latest technology, so in order to make it also emotionally even more interesting for people to deal with them. And with this, I would like to land back home now, providing you just the last message, which is the following. We are living in a beautiful place. It's offering us everything for free. Now, we are growing, we are getting more and more. We have to change attitudes. We have to use our creativity to produce new way of augmenting the resources we need. So, Warka is an example. Many more can be done. And this wants to be for you as an inspirational point to start for new adventure to come. Thank you very much.